Alright guys, this is Mr. TARDIS and welcome to Mr. TARDIS Reviews. Now normally I'd open these reviews with a joke or a sketch or something like that, but let's just be serious for a minute. To be honest, I have been pretty worried at the quality of the episodes this series. So for me personally, A Good Man Goes to War does have quite a lot riding on its shoulders. So can Stephen Moffat deliver us a satisfying mid-series finale?
Would you like me to repeat the question?
Okay guys, like I said, I'd normally make a few jokes, beat around the bush a bit, before I get into the main crux of the review, but not here, oh no, because let me tell you, that as a mid-series finale, A Good Man Goes to War kicks ass. Now, about the plot. Amy is a ganger, the Doctor has known all along, and now Amy has given birth to her baby, Melody Pond. But the eyepatch lady, named Madame Covarian, is planning to kidnap the child for reasons that are made clear by the end of the episode. The Doctor calls in debts from across time and space in order to lead a full frontal assault against the villain's base, Demon's Run, to save Melody and to get Amy back. In this episode, we're given Sontarans, Silurians, Cybermen, Dorium, Jadoon, Gangers, Eyepatch Lady, Spitfires, and... oh no, not you again.
This episode is doing something quite different from past Doctor Who finales. Normally they'd rely on recurring themes, but in this case they're mostly relying on recurring characters.
Did somebody say recurring characters?
What? Who the hell are you?
You haven't met me yet. Shh. Spoilers.
You're a fish. Get out!
Okay.
Oh, well, that was weird. So anyway, what the hell is that? Oh! Oh shit, what the hell was that?
One of the main reasons I love this episode is because it seems to bring Stephen Moffat's concept of the Doctor full circle. What do I mean by this? Well, every person who has been in charge of Doctor Who since its inception in 1963 has had some idea as to what the Doctor should be like. Russell T. Davis saw him as a lonely, guilt-ridden old man. But now we can see how Stephen Moffat sees the Doctor. He sees him as a man gone too far, a character who has gotten to the point where just his reputation can make others frightened of him. This is clear from his story Forest of the Dead, when he asked the Vashta Narada to look him up. And what does the Doctor say to the Atraxi at the end of the 11th hour?
Basically, run.
Heck, Stephen Moffat devoted his first series finale into rounding up aliens who are so scared of him destroying the universe that they lock him up. The Doctor has lived for so long, has travelled so far, that nearly everybody knows him, and many of them fear him. One of the main complaints from fans is, why would anybody want to stop the Doctor? He's a good guy. Well, first things first, good is a point of view. Someone's evil is another person's good, and vice versa. But look at it this way. Since the series came back, it's been established that he's wiped out the Time Lords and the Daleks, pretty much, destroyed entire fleets of aliens, can turn armies around at the mention of his name, and for those that he's spared, he's made the rest of their existence miserable. Whether he's fighting for good or not. Who wouldn't want a weapon capable of those things? Yes, the Doctor is ultimately fighting for good, but his power and experience could be catastrophic in the wrong hands, and it makes me grateful that he's on our side. I absolutely loved the first half of this episode when we didn't see the Doctor. When he destroyed the cyberships, that was an amazing sequence, and that scene with him confronting Dorium, it was so wonderfully handled, and it even seemed to establish the Doctor as some sort of monster, which I loved. Oh, and I know a few people didn't like that Cybermen scene. I thought it was very well placed, because it was in this episode to remind the audience right off the bat of the Doctor's destructive powers, and what he's capable of before this episode starts doing something with that concept. But Matt Smith helps to bump all of this subtext up a notch, as he gives quite possibly his definitive performance as the Doctor. While every scene he's in is incredible, my favourite and my Matt Smith moment of the week has to be the scene when he confronts Colonel Manton.
Colonel Manton, I want you to tell your men to run away.
What?
Those words, run away. I want you to be famous for those exact words. I want people to call you Colonel Runaway. I want children laughing outside your door because they've found the house of Colonel Runaway.
And when people come to you and ask if trying to get to me through the people I love...
Is it anyway a good idea? I want you to tell them your name.
Stephen Moffat has written some of the best Doctor Who speeches, and this is no exception. You can clearly see the Doctor's emotions getting to him during those lines, and the dialogue is already great to begin with. You can see a man starting to lose control, and it's even starting to scare him. But like I said, Matt Smith is great in every scene here, and as for Amy Pond...
Can I borrow your gun?
Why?
Because I've got a feeling you're going to keep talking.
My God, that sounds like something Rose Tyler would say. And that's not a good thing.
But yeah, apart from that incredibly out-of-character line, Karen Gillan and Arthur Darvill are great in this episode, especially Arthur, who seems to impress me more and more each week.
Where is my Sparta?
The supporting cast in this episode is easily one of the most impressive this series, as there are many recurring actors here. Dorian, played by Simon Fisher-Becker, is a very nice, well-rounded character. A character who knows when to stop, is not afraid to accept his limitations, but is a bit of a coward and quite naive. I felt genuinely upset when he died at the end. I've always had a love of the Sontarans, and this episode gave us a great one with Strax, played by Dan Starkey, who played Commander Skaar in the Sontaran Stratagem and the Poison Sky. In fact, Strax may be one of the best Sontaran personalities since Commander Lynx in The Time Warrior. The performance is the most redeeming aspect here, as the character is given a lot of dry and deadpan humour, which isn't easy to pull off, but Dan absolutely nails it here, giving us a very funny character.
Will I be okay?
Of course you will, my boy. You'll be up and around in no time. And perhaps one day, you and I shall meet on the field of battle, and I will destroy you for the glory of the Sontaran Empire.
And what do I have to say about Vastra the Silurian?
Jack the Ripper has claimed his last victim.
How did you find him?
Stringy, but tasty all the same.
Spin off, spin off, spin off!
Just give Big Finish the licenses to all these characters and let's hear their stories. That's the mark of great characters, when you want to learn more about them and where they came from. But this has also become a criticism of the episode. People have been complaining because they don't understand why these characters owe a debt to the Doctor. But to be honest, I like that. The Doctor is over 900 years old and we've only seen a handful of his adventures. Who says that some stuff didn't happen off screen? Maybe the 7th Doctor ran into Strax and he did something to help. I love letting my imagination fill in the blanks with things like this. It makes the Doctor feel part of a larger story and it helps make the universe feel bigger as a result, which is why I felt the Lorna Bucket aspect worked as well as it did. And I might as well talk about the character of Lorna while I'm here. At first, I felt she was very underdeveloped. Yes, she'd met the Doctor as a child and that she has tried to find him again. So far, so love and monsters. She meets the Doctor before she dies and he tells her that he remembers her. Okay, I couldn't care less. Until the Doctor turns around and says...
Who was she?
My heart broke at that point. The Doctor has no idea who she is, and yet she died for him. We were left in the dark because the Doctor was as well. That was the entire point, and that final reveal was a huge punch to the gut.
They're always brave.
That right there, for me, was the best moment of the episode. You remember in Journey's End when Davros told the Doctor how many had died in his name, and he made this huge speech about it and there was a minute-long montage getting this across? Well, it's done so much better here because it's summed up in a single line, and the delivery from Matt Smith is just magnificent. They're always brave. The direction from Peter Hoare is just incredible as well. Peter is a television directing veteran, and his experience over the years is put to great use here. There's a huge sense of scale and size throughout the episode. The camera is rarely static during the action, which helps keep the momentum high, and the way he shoots some scenes makes them incredibly chilling, but only for those who can appreciate the small details.
As you can probably tell, I love this episode. But before I talk about the big ending, I'm just going to talk about a few places where I think this episode fell a bit short.
The script at points is incredibly tight and it moves along at a brilliant pace, but suddenly Stephen Moffat might take a slight detour and shift the focus for no particular reason on something that's clearly not as important, or he'll try and misdirect the audience for no other reason than to just misdirect the audience. Trying to trick people into thinking the Doctor is the father of the baby is not clever. It's just irritating to watch and it just kills the momentum. And what about the fat and thin gay couple? Yes, they were fun to watch, but couldn't that screen time have maybe been used to give the Doctor and Strax a scene together? Or maybe learn a bit more about the headless monks? You've got a really great story here, so just tell it instead of taking it on random detours. Oh, and why did they have to bring the Spitfires back for 10 seconds? Many fans are trying to forget Victory of the Daleks. Looking back, I don't mind the Spitfires so much, but the first time it just felt like one inclusion that just came too far out of left field. You have Jadoon here. Why couldn't you just use one of their ships instead of getting random Spitfires? Not to mention the Doctor rising and falling. While he did rise and fall, he has definitely risen higher and he has definitely fallen further. Maybe he still has further to fall, but right now it just seemed like a lot of build-up, but with little payoff. Oh, and without a drop of blood spilt? I'm guessing the monks and the soldiers that died earlier didn't count.
But these complaints are just small niggles against a very powerful story. Now, let's talk about the ending.
Okay, so it's revealed that the Doctor has been fooled twice the same way. He puts the pieces together in his head and runs to his friends fighting to protect Melody. Then, just as he reaches them, it is revealed that... Amy gave birth to Pudding! Nope, Melody has been replaced with a Ganger avatar thing in order to protect the villain's best chances of fighting the Doctor, and she's been raised on Earth to become the astronaut at the beginning of the series. And then we find out that River Song is actually Melody Pond. While there were many theories around the internet before this episode came out after it was revealed the baby would be called Melody Pond, if you figured it out, then go you. But whether you guessed it or not, the way it was revealed was really well handled. The Doctor figuring it out first without telling us helped to raise the tension until the final reveal. So anyway, the most interesting thing about this reveal is not only the fact that River Song is Amy and Rory's daughter, but she was also made to become a weapon against the Doctor. It did make a great ending to this mid-series finale, because not only did it answer a few questions, but it also raised a few more, which hopefully will be revealed in the next 6 episodes. But I'll give my conclusion now before I talk about the future. A Good Man Goes to War may have set itself a bit too high, and sometimes it seems to easily get distracted by other concepts, but it more than makes up for it with a compelling script, great characters and greater performances. The emotions here are balanced perfectly, giving us hilarious comedy 1 minute and then bringing in some effective drama the next. I don't think this episode will age well because of its place as a mid-series finale, but as of now I'm going to watch this episode again and again and enjoy the hell out of it. As for the future of this series, I don't think it's going to be individual stories in a conventional sense. There are 6 episodes left and the Doctor can't just go on random adventures after finding out who the child is because he'd be leaving Amy and Rory without their baby. So I'm going to assume that these stories are either going to be one after the other or they're going to be heavily linked together, but time will tell. It always does.
So, thanks for watching and I'll see you guys next time.
trumpets!